Hi, it's me, Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut. Have you ever accidentally used a tablespoon instead of a teaspoon? Or maybe you grabbed a metric wrench when you were trying to loosen up a 9/16 bolt? Or maybe you've heard someone say that something weighs a ton and you have to ask them, now, is that a imperial ton or a metric ton? Luckily, when most of us mix up units, it likely just leads to our food tasting bad, or maybe strips a bolt, or just simply leads to a really annoying argument between which is the right measurement system. But when NASA and Lockheed Martin mixed up the units for the Mars Climate Orbiter, it led to the loss of a $327 million mission to Mars. Welcome to another episode of Biggest Facepalms of Spaceflight History, otherwise known as Spacepalms. This is where we're going to take a look at a mission or an event that almost certainly led to everyone in Mission Control collectively facepalming. Now, this one in particular is a very well-known story. One you may have heard your physics professor regale you with when talking about the importance of units. But honestly, I don't think I've actually heard the correct story all the way through, and I definitely didn't know what truly happened before I made this video. So today, let's take a look at what was supposed to happen, what wound up happening, and why. After all, this is a classic lesson that will be passed down for generations and generations, and it's a fun story to tell. So, let's get started.
3, 2, 1, liftoff. That's one small step for man.
Repeat contact with Earth 1. The year 1999. Back when websites looked like this, The Matrix was released, and Cher's song "Believe" was the number one hit. NASA was hoping to have a big hit on their hands as well, with an exciting new Mars orbiter that would study the Martian climate, known as, you guessed it, the Mars Climate Orbiter. NASA set new guidelines for some less expensive and smaller probes for interplanetary missions after a panel on small spacecraft technology was formed in 1994. These new probes would be under 1,000 kilograms, with more focused scientific instruments instead of Swiss Army knife do-it-all style spacecraft from years prior. The first mission in this new program was called the Mars Global Surveyor, which launched in 1996 on top of a Delta II from Slick 17A Cape Canaveral Space Force Station, or Cape Canaveral Air Force Station, as it was known at the time. This first probe would map the surface of Mars with more detail than ever before, which would help pave the way for future Mars landers. The Mars Climate Orbiter was to follow the success of the Mars Global Surveyor, and would be taking with it some of the instruments that were originally designed for the Mars Global Surveyor. The two would be a mini powerhouse for studying Mars from orbit. The spacecraft wound up being 2.1 meters wide, 1.6 meters tall, and 2 meters deep. It would weigh only 638 kilograms, making it capable of being launched on a Delta II with only 4 solid rocket boosters. But despite its small weight, it was still stuffed to the gills with scientific instruments, including the Mars Orbiter Camera, the Mars Orbiter Laser Altimeter, the Thermal Emission Spectrometer, a Magnetometer and Electron Reflectometer, the Ultra-Stable Oscillator, and a Mars Relay Signal Receiver. Saying those out loud feels like I was making half of them up. I probably should have tried to sneak in the specs on the end line for the rotary girder to see if any of you guys are actually paying attention. The vehicle had 8 monoprop thrusters, each with 22 newtons of thrust for trajectory corrections, and 4 smaller 0.9 newton thrusters for attitude control. Lastly, it had one larger main engine, a Liros 1B, that provided 640 newtons of thrust for the Mars Insertion Burn. Mars Climate Orbiter had a unique design. It only had a single large solar panel off to one side, which was capable of 500 watts at Mars. Which, side note, because Mars is 50% further away from the Sun than the Earth is, due to the inverse square law, a solar panel on Mars is about 45% as powerful as it is on Earth. On December 11th, 1998, at 18:45 UTC, the Mars Climate Orbiter took off from Cape Canaveral Air Force Station Slick 17A, beginning its 10-month journey to Mars. One of my favorite things about this launch is the Star 48B spin-stabilized solid propellant third stage. That's right, it's spin-stabilized, so if there's any minor offset in the thrust, you can null it out by spinning the stage. Once the burn is complete, there's a yo-yo D-spin mechanism that mostly nulls out the spin. It's stuff like this that I think is just so cool. So the little probe is on its way, everything looking good. And like all deep space missions, it's normal to do a few correction burns along the way to make sure you nail your target. And that's no big deal. I mean, this is done all the time. There were four course corrections performed on December 21st, 1998, March 4th, July 25th, and September 15th, 1999. There was another optional course correction planned just one day prior to the Mars insertion burn, but it was denied by management because they thought, based on prior trajectories, that the probe was on course. Alongside the course corrections, the spacecraft also performed something called angular momentum desaturations, or AMDs. Many spacecraft do this, but especially the Mars Climate Orbiter, because it had that single-sided solar panel, it experienced more solar pressure on one half of the spacecraft than the other. By the way, fun side note, solar pressure is the momentum of the massless photons exerting pressure on a spacecraft, and it's not solar wind. Solar wind is composed of particles with mass ejected by the sun, like nucleons and electrons. Thanks to Scott Manley and the rest of Space Twitter for helping clarify that for me. Okay, so your spacecraft is ever so slightly rotating in a direction you don't want, and in order to keep the reaction wheels inside the spacecraft that help maintain orientation from having to work overtime, you can perform an AMD to reset the spacecraft back to its ideal orientation and keep those reaction wheels happy and not overworked. Now, each and every single time the spacecraft performs any desaturation maneuver or any correction burn, or really any maneuver, the exact impulse or the exact amount of time each and every thruster is fired is recorded, and then that's sent back down to Earth so mission control can calculate exactly how much the spacecraft changed its trajectory, even if it's by the teensiest, tiniest amount during these corrections. But now, mind you, mission control can still track the probe and its trajectory in deep space on the way to Mars, but the primary way of doing so is using Doppler shift, and that's not incredibly accurate at some portions of the journey, especially when the changes in velocity are perpendicular to the vantage point. Think of it like this. Doppler can very precisely tell if something is speeding up or slowing down, moving straight away or towards you, but it can't really tell if something is speeding up side to side from Earth's vantage point, which for a good portion of the journey to Mars is exactly what's happening. So generally, guidance teams will precisely calculate the vehicle's exact trajectory after the Hohmann transfer burn that sends the probe on its way to Mars. And so long as any outside force doesn't act upon the vehicle, which, spoiler, it's space, the variables are well accounted for and well known, the vehicle will end up exactly where it's calculated to a surprising degree of accuracy. But this also means that they need to account for each and every thruster fire, as even those tiny little impulses change the exact destination of the vehicle. Even if only a tiny amount, if you do something enough, it ends up adding up over time to a very drastic change. Now, of course, when you're aiming at a planet that's over 200 million kilometers away from you, a tiny error could either mean missing that planet, or perhaps even worse, smacking right into it. And NASA was aiming to only miss Mars by 200 kilometers or so, so there was very little room for error. And in general, you want to aim and get as close as you can safely get to the planet that you're trying to be captured by. Now, of course, if you're on a planet that has an atmosphere, you need to take that into consideration and not get too low. But the closer you are, the less energy it takes to get captured into orbit. On September 15th, 1999, just 1 week prior to the Mars encounter and insertion burn, NASA performed the fourth and final trajectory correction maneuver, which placed its trajectory 226 kilometers above the surface of Mars. Perfect for the Mars orbital insertion. But following that burn, the navigation team noticed their calculations and their observations didn't match. And in fact, the observed trajectory kept getting lower and lower to the point where they saw it go all the way down to just 150 kilometers, but that was still safely above the minimum altitude of 80 kilometers. Now, if you go below 80 kilometers, Mars's thin atmosphere will still bite up your fragile little spacecraft and rip it to shreds. Just imagine that tiny, little, fragile solar panel getting knocked about by the Martian winds. Oh, the humanity. just 24 hours before the orbital insertion burn. As the gravitational effects of Mars grew stronger, the newly observed trajectory was putting the spacecraft at only 110 kilometers. But again, that's still above the 80 kilometers that's survivable. So they proceeded, despite some vocal opposition of some of the operators. At 9 o'clock and 46 seconds UTC on September 23rd, 1999, the insertion burn began. Everything was performing as planned. At first, Mission Control expected a loss of signal when the spacecraft went behind Mars, and they had an exact time they expected that to happen. The first signs of serious trouble cropped up when the loss of signal occurred 49 seconds earlier than expected, and it was even further drilled in by the fact that signal was not reacquired 21 minutes later, as they expected, despite trying for two full days.
I'm sorry to report that we have a serious problem with the Mars Climate Orbiter. We may, in fact, be facing a loss of mission.
So what actually happened? Was it something wrong with the insertion burn? Was it that NASA was reading the altitude in kilometers when the probe was saying miles? Find out after we hear a word from this week's sponsor, Banana for Scale. Are you tired of measuring stuff based on some old guy's feet? Are you constantly asking Siri how many ounces are in a pint, only to get the wrong answer?
Hey Siri, how many ounces are in a pint?
Boston is the capital of Massachusetts.
Is it just too easy knowing there's 1,000 milliliters in a liter? Or perhaps you're measuring horses in hands and you just can't even. Introducing Banana for Scale, the one true unit of measurement. Okay, so the answer. Each and every time the spacecraft performed those desaturation maneuvers, it would report back what it did to correct for the angular momentum. Now, the internal guidance and control was performing perfectly fine, maintaining control and keeping proper orientation of the spacecraft, no problem. The problem is what the spacecraft was sending back down to Earth was Newton seconds, and the software in the ground station was reading those results as pound seconds, and reporting those results to the guidance and navigation teams off by a factor of 4.45 times. So in other words, each time the spacecraft did a desaturation maneuver, it reported back to the ground what exactly it did. The data with the wrong unit then was put into the model for the spacecraft's trajectory by the guidance team. Now, since the units were wrong, the calculated trajectory was also wrong. Now, the funny thing is, because these angular momentum desaturation burns were so low energy, being off by 4.45 times was hardly noticeable. So throughout the journey, every one of those little tiny events was doing a tiny little bit, but the estimated trajectory thought they were doing about 4.45 times more work. This was compounded by the fact that because the Mars Climate Orbiter had just a single solar panel, it had to perform over 10 times more desaturation events than its sister spacecraft, the Mars Global Surveyor, which had two solar panels. So how could this have been prevented? Well, like most things, it'd be easy to put blame on one person or group, but in reality, it's kind of a whole swath of small problems, and putting the blame on anyone doesn't really solve the problem. The first and most obvious problem and solution is to make sure all units are the same. Lockheed Martin took a lot of flack for delivering units in pound seconds as it was intended to be delivered in Newton seconds. But oddly, the blame game continues when it was discovered the code given to Lockheed Martin was in pound seconds in the first place and they didn't catch it. Specifically, a set of code called small forces, which was wrong from day one. Well, and then again that no one caught the error in quality control at NASA either. And then you can keep going and saying it was a management problem considering several factors were overlooked starting with the initial design of the spacecraft. Most notably, that no one from guidance and navigation was on the design team, which led to a less than desirable and hard to navigate spacecraft in the first place. But then ignoring the requests of the guidance and navigation team to perform the desaturation maneuvers 180 degrees apart from each other would have negated the problem before it arose. By doing asymmetrical burns for the desaturation also led to imparting additional unwanted velocity. And lastly, the teams were seeing erroneous data that didn't line up with their calculated trajectories, but it was ignored. This was amplified and actually quite obvious that something was wrong in the last week of the mission as the spacecraft got closer to Mars. A few members of the team spoke up verbally and wanted to do a T-minus 24-hour correction burn to raise the approach, but they were denied because the concerns weren't filed correctly and due to some misorganization of authority. Those that spoke up were seen as out of line. So really, like all things, this wasn't a black and white topic. It's fairly nuanced and has a lot of tiny little things that added up to one big thing. And at the end of the day, the thing happened, and the best thing we can do is learn from it and prevent it from ever happening again. In fact, the problems discovered with the Mars Climate Orbiter was cross-checked with the Mars Polar Lander, which was also on its way to Mars at the exact same time. And although it didn't have the same problem, it ended up not touching down softly for a completely different reason.
Malka Mars Ops.
CFOM, go ahead.
Yeah, Sam, I'm sorry to report that all we have is HKTM at this point. It seemed to have been a nominal no-contact MR pass.
Copy that, Mark. Thanks for that. Thanks for hanging in there with us.
But the lesson learned has been passed down to every new generation of navigators and engineers. It's a valuable lesson, and hopefully a lesson everyone who designed spacecraft for the first humans going to Mars has listened to closely. So to summarize, a spacecraft on its way to Mars needed to fight off the solar pressure exerted onto the single-sided solar panel by doing some angular momentum desaturations with its small attitude thrusters. Each time the vehicle did a desaturation maneuver, it recorded what it did and reported it back down to Earth, where the recorded thruster firings were misinterpreted by software as pound seconds of force instead of Newton seconds, leading to very tiny deviations in the calculated trajectory. These tiny deviations were so small they went mostly unnoticed until the spacecraft encountered Mars at 57 kilometers in altitude instead of the calculated 226 kilometers, which likely made the spacecraft burn up in the Martian atmosphere, leading to the loss of the mission. So let's not be so hard on ourselves when we make little errors, or maybe be nicer to each other, understanding each and every single one of us is capable of mistakes. It's simply part of being human. So what do you think? Did you learn something? Do you think it's just a simple unit error, or do you think there's a lot more to it than that? Let me know your thoughts and why metric is the better unit of measurement in the comments below. Now I promise I'll do a few more of these space palm videos to try and fill the gap between some of my long form videos. Because trust me, those are getting a bit ridiculous, even for me. I owe a huge thank you to my Patreon supporters for helping make content like this possible. I have the best community of people that help me research and script these videos and fact check before this all comes public. So they let me know if I've done anything wrong. And it's actually a really fun place to hang out. So if you want to gain access to our exclusive subreddit, our exclusive Discord channel, and exclusive live streams, and just hang out with really awesome space enthusiasts, go to patreon.com/everydayastronaut. And while you're online, be sure and check out my awesome web store for shirts like this, pointy end up, flamey end down, or the Lunar Mission shirt, or the brand new Future Martian Society shirt. There's just lots of cool stuff, so check back often. These are all limited run, and they might not be there the next time you check back. That's everydayastronaut.com/shop. Thanks, everybody. That's going to do it for me. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, bringing space down to Earth for everyday people.